Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you. We'll see how many people are listening right now. All right, there we go. I got a few. All right, giddy up. Hey, if you're joining us online or you're joining us in person, we're glad that you're here with us this morning. If you're joining us in person, you may have noticed something uniquely different this morning. If not, look around beside you, to your left and your right. See if you've got a new cushion or an old cushion. The new cushions are coming. Some of them are already done. You may notice a little bit of a difference in how you're body sits. We're thankful to have that happening right now. We won't go any further into that, but the new padding is a nice feature. Hopefully we won't see anybody dozing off during sermon today. If we do, we're coming for you, okay? Either way, we are still so glad that you are here with us today. It's just good to be in God's house this morning, and we're thankful for a beautiful day outside and a beautiful chance to be together. So again, my joy to be able to welcome you today. If you're a guest with us, I hope you'll take time and look at that little QR code, maybe snap that and let us know a little more information about you so that we can better minister to you. We're not going to come show up at your house randomly, I promise. It's just a way that we can reach out and connect with you in a better way and make sure you feel a part of what we're doing here at Parkway Baptist Church. Well, listen, we are grateful that you're here. If you would, do me a favor, everybody stand up and greet one another this morning. Let everybody know you're glad they're here today.
Good morning, how you guys doing? The good news is I can tell your vocal cords are warmed up. Heard lots of good communication going on out there. And that's gonna come in really handy because I need a lot of help. Because here at the beginning of this very first song, if you have breath in your lungs and there is proof that there is a lot of breath in this room, we're gonna praise the Lord. And so I'm gonna need you to sing it out, shout it out. Whatever you do, bring the energy. All right, and give it all that you got, because if you've got breath in your lungs, and we all do, we're going to use it to praise the Lord this morning. Won't hurt my feelings if you clap either. Here we go.
Let everything that has breath.
I'm sure, and I'll breathe when I'm down.
Ready to praise him this morning? I hope so. I mean, if you're not now, I don't know what it's going to take, because that's about all the energy that we can muster up here. But in all seriousness, I mean, what better could we use our breath for than offering it back to our Creator and Savior this morning? I'm going to read from Acts chapter 1, and just a couple of verses that I think are really key and some really cool moments here. And it says in verse 3, this is talking about Jesus, is after he had suffered, he also presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And then in verse 8 it says, and this is Jesus giving them his last instructions, you know, he's appeared, he's resurrected, and here he says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And I'm really drawn to that word witnesses there, because this is a group of people that had witnessed a lot. These disciples had witnessed Jesus' teachings. They had witnessed miracles. They had witnessed healings. They had witnessed him die on a cross. They were in total despair. They witnessed him resurrected, and he spends 40 days pouring into them. And he gives them this instruction, and it's very clear, as amazing as those things were that they witnessed, and they could have just soaked them in, and they would have really just enjoyed all the time they spent with the Lord, and they would have said, oh, that was so amazing. Our God is so good. But he says, it's not just for you to keep. You are to go. You are going to be my witnesses, because you are going to take this message, because there is a world that needs it. And I just want to ask you this morning, what have you witnessed? Have you witnessed the goodness of our God? Have you witnessed his saving grace? Because there is a world outside these walls that desperately needs it. Will you be his witnesses? And will you go and take that message this week? As we disperse, this song that we're about to sing is going to talk about all the things that we witnessed, and they are amazing, and we can rejoice in them, and we can praise him for them, but it doesn't end there. We have to take them with us, and we have to go and tell this world, because there is a dying world that is desperate to know the Savior that we know and hold so dear. Let's continue to worship this morning.
Was where I found hope.
constant, I've witnessed it, and I'm confident I'll see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it. You heal and I've witnessed it. You save and I've witnessed it. sprang to life again, and I was made for more. So why would I make a bed in my shame when a fountain of grace is running my way? I know I am yours, and I was made for more. 'Cause I wasn't made to be tend in a grave. I was born by name, and born and raised back to life again, and I was made for more. And so
God, we are so grateful for that fountain of grace that is running our way. We are so grateful, Lord, as the lost sheep, that you came running for us. How can we not live differently because of that? How can we not live like changed people when we have been changed? Lord, we love you so much. All of this praise is yours, and we lay it at your feet today. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You guys can take a seat. Children first through third grade, y'all are dismissed.
Good morning, Parkway family. It is the election week, in case you didn't know. Lots of discussion, lots of anxiousness, maybe a little bit of fear going on this week. If you haven't voted yet, I hope that you will, and I hope that you will seek the Lord, and you will pray hard and look into His Word about what matters to God, and that your heart would be stirred, and that you'll go make your voice matter, and your vote matters. And this past week, I stood in a line for 90 minutes. Didn't have anything else to do. I thought I'd check some email and do a little thing family-wise, and then I struck up a conversation with the lady in front of me. Had a baby stroller, and the baby was throwing out the pacifier, so I started helping, putting it back in, and for the next 90 minutes, had a great conversation about the Lord and her husband and her family, and moved here from South Carolina. So if Sydney, if you're watching today, you and your husband Ryan and little boy Noah, thanks for making the pass the time. praying for you and your church and all that God is doing in your life. As you're looking at the election, maybe you start wondering, what if the other side wins? What is my family going to be like? What is my life going to be like if that happens? What's going to happen to grocery prices, to the stock market? Some of the parents, you may be wondering, what is this world coming to that I'm going to be handing this to my kids? What are they going to endure? My grandkids, what are they going to endure? All over our country, there seems to be a sense of concern, heightened concern, borderlying on fear. Fear is something that we come in contact with all the time. And fear can be good, it can be debilitating, and we're going to be looking at how fear can hijack our life and take us to a place where God does not want us to be. And so we're going to go into a series called Fear Not. I'm hopeful that God will speak to your heart and that many of you will find deliverance and freedom from the fear and the concerns of the world, from the voices both internal and external that rage against you and your heart and your peace and your contentment, and that God will give you victory in these next few weeks. So let's talk about what fear is. Let's start with a definition of what fear is. Fear is a fundamental emotion that is characterized by an intense response to a real or a perceived threat or danger. Fear by itself is not a bad thing. Fear is helpful. Fear is designed to protect you against things that could harm you. When I was a kid growing up, I was watching my dad grill, and he was out there on the grill, and I would come out and stand beside him, and he would say, "Don't touch that, that's hot." Well, I didn't, that wasn't enough for me. I had to experience for myself. And so when Dad wasn't looking, I reached out and touched the grill. And a bunch of blisters and melted skin later, I realized that Dad was right. That's hot. It hurts. And I developed a healthy fear for a hot grill and fire. Fear can be helpful because it protects us from obvious things that are dangerous to us. But when fear becomes an obsession and a phobia, it takes over our lives and it can paralyze you and it can keep you from living the best life that God wants you to have. There are things in our life that are good phobias. There are fears. There are good things that take over our life and become a phobia. I'd like to share with you some of the top fears in America right now. I'd like to do a little survey. If this is you, I'll get you to sound off a little bit. And if it bothers you a little bit, close your eyes. Don't get up and run out of the room, right? So one of the first fears that a lot of people have is this one. Fear of spiders. Arachnophobia. If that's you, say, yep. Not very many of you. Okay. No, not a big fear of that. We'll just leave that up for a little bit. You know, spider is a real fear, right? Because there are some spiders that can harm you. Nothing wrong with having a fear of a spider. There's like one or two that are actually poisonous and can hurt you. Good reason to have fear. Maybe too much fear would keep you from even going out in the yard because there might be a spider. This time of year in the fall, there's webs everywhere, right? You know, they're in your yard. You might have used them for decoration this last week. But there are spiders is a fear, right? This next one, yeah, fear of snakes. My wife just about got up and left the room. Just close your eyes, Heather. We done. This fear is called ophidiophobia, the fear of snakes. If that's you, say yep. Yeah, that's a bigger yeah right there. We might want to blank that out, Ty. You might want to just kind of go to a blank screen. Fear of snake makes sense, right? Thank you. See? You feel better? You feel better? A fear of snakes is real because some of them can hurt you. When we lived in Florida, we had a non-poisonous black racer snake living in our backyard. Turned out there was three of them. I thought there was one because I eliminated one of them, and I still had two more. They just kept showing up. I was like, where are these things coming from? And people said, Matt, you shouldn't eliminate the snake because it's not poisonous, but it's like 8 feet long. And I was like, if someone comes to buy this house that we're trying to sell and they see the resident 8-foot-long black racer, this house is never going to sell. So between the house and the snake needs to go, right? But it is a healthy fear to stay away from a snake because some snakes, probably more than spiders, can harm you. Therefore, it's a healthy fear as long as it doesn't ruin your life. I can't go outside because I might run into something that even looks remotely like that. And I am not proponent for all snakes or bad snakes. I'm just saying it is a healthy fear that that you might fear that. And for those of you who said, yep, did that picture give you a little anxiousness right there when it was up? Ty, put it back up just for fun. And see if you, now do you feel it? You feel that moment of, maybe it's an ick, or maybe it's a ouch, or maybe it's an actual uncomfortableness. That is a fear. Ask yourself, where does that come from? And why does that bother you so much? We'll go to the next one. The next fear is heights. Acrophobia. Why somebody would be in flip-flops on the edge of a building is beyond me, because there's just so much that could go wrong in that moment. And I don't know if I'm really afraid of heights. For them, am I really afraid of that, or am I just concerned for their lack of wisdom, right? Do I see their stupidity and they're like, why are you standing on the edge of anything like that? Because a natural fear says falling from a height can hurt you. So it's a natural fear, but maybe this fear of height can be very debilitating. If you can't drive across a bridge, then maybe it's having a strong effect on your life, and it's overboard fear. I found that a fear of heights, I have a little bit of that. It makes me a better climber. Like, I did a little climbing and rappelling, and I like climbing better because I could hang on to something, and I could like grip it really tight, and that fear helped me get to the top. But rappelling is a different story, because now you're just free falling on a rope, and I didn't like that feel of free falling from a height. A little bit of a free fall is fine, but I have a little bit of acrophobia in me. I didn't realize it till I got up high, and yeah, it's still there. How about this next one? Here's one. Closed spaces, claustrophobia. Oh, wait, I didn't say. Those of you scared of heights, say yep. Yeah, not many. Okay. Closed spaces, claustrophobia. I didn't know I had that until I was playing football one day, and I got tackled, and the dog pile just piled on top of me, and I was pinned in, and I couldn't move. And then something inside of me just panicked. I knew it was temporary, but I just had this overwhelming sense of emotion of, I got to get out of this pile. I could breathe a little bit, enough, but the fact that I was pinned in and confined just really bothered me. I don't know how some of you go caving. I think you're crazy. Our teenagers have gone, our children have gone caving. If you are crawling through a tunnel and you are crawling in such a small space that you have to take your helmet off and push it through the tunnel in front of you because it won't fit, I'm not going. I'm just telling you. I'm not going to go into that little bit of a tube, because the idea that you're crawling under in the social confined space, and the person in front of you, and there's a person behind you, and there's no turning around. Am I bothering some of you? You can't go backwards. You can't go forwards. And if that person in front of you gets stuck, what are you going to do? And I have had nightmares about that. And just talking about it is making me just a little bit uncomfortable. So I'm going to move on from this one. If claustrophobia is one of yours, say yep. Yeah, okay. See, you didn't know it was until I just described caving. And now you're like, well, I don't know what that's like, but I'm never going. Don't go caving. I mean, those of you who can do it, God bless you. But I could not crawl into those confined spaces. So bless you for that. That is that's claustrophobia. There's another one that we didn't get the picture in there of. It is the fear of clowns. We don't have a picture. The fear of clowns is called bozoophobia. That's really not the name of it. But some of you know what I'm talking about. But a fear of clowns, and I guess we left it out because it would traumatize some people and they would get up and run out. Maybe bozoophobia, maybe that's not such a reality, that the clown's really not going to hurt you, and yet you respond the same way. You're fearful and you're afraid. When you see it, there's an emotion that goes off in your body, and clowns kind of disturb you. And you probably haven't been to the circus in a while, or you sit in the very back row if you do go to the circus. Maybe it's because they get like 15 in one car and that bothers you. You don't know how they fit all those in there. But clown, bozoophobia is a real thing. And some people, and then the last one, I don't really understand. It's the fear of butterflies. Lepidopterophobia is the fear of butterflies. I don't know if this one is grounded in reality. I'm not sure if butterflies are really a threat to us. And yet, for some people, they experience the fear. I mean, there's no poisonous butterflies, right? They're just cute and they flutter, and maybe their wings bother you. Anybody here have a fear of butterflies? Say, yep. None. See, I don't know. It's kind of rare, but it's not a perceived threat. Therefore, there's not a phobia for that is associated with it, unless that there's something inside of you that triggers when you see a butterfly, and if it lands on you, it's a physical response of, all of us have fears. All of us have things that we come in contact with, and sometimes the fears are normal and they're just self-protecting, and other times the fears are out of control and they hijack your life and they take you to a place that you should never even go. What does it look like when you and I try to overcome our fears? There was this TV show called Fear Factor, and that was their whole premise, making people face their fears. I want you to watch one guy who said, I'm not afraid of heights. What he said, watch his emotional reaction and how his body reacts when he actually gets up there. Watch this.
Six contestants, three stunts, one winner.
Yes! Woo!
Fear Factor.
Are you afraid of heights?
Honestly, I'm not scared of nothing. I've never done anything to be scared. It's all in the mind. It's nothing about the physical. It's all about your mental. Are you prepared to go out there and do it?
Oh, no, not yet, not yet.
Oh, look at his little legs.
Can't wait till you stabilize.
Oh.
You got it. All right, book anytime you want. You got plenty of time.
Hold on. I want to see 10.
Hold on. Look down.
Oh.
We'll have a cup of coffee while you're hanging out there.
Do this, baby. Let's do it. One, two. No.
Still got another minute and a half, man. You got plenty of time.
Next challenge, please. I don't blame you. I wouldn't like that one either. Did you notice he didn't think he had a fear, but when faced with it, all of a sudden he has an emotional response. He's squealing, and then he has a physical response when he gets to the bottom. When we have fear, sometimes it hijacks us. I want to show you where the root and the cause of fear comes from. And we're going to look at the life of Elijah, and we're going to see how he walked through these stages in a normal day in the life of a follower of God. And we're going to watch him go through these stages of success and failure and fear. And we're going to see how God saved him from all that. The first thing I want you to see in Elijah's story is that we're going to see that fear comes from the dangers that we see around us, real dangers that you and I see all around us, and some of us are going through them, difficulty and pain and heartache, and you look around in your life and it's real. And you say, man, I'm not making this up. This is like something that's imaginary. These are real things that I'm struggling with in my life, and it causes me fear. The dangers that you see. If you have your Bibles, turn to 1 Kings chapter 19. We're going to look at the life of Elijah. And while you're turning there, let me catch you up. He had just had this great battle with the prophets of Baal. He challenged hundreds of false prophets to a battle. And he said, hey, you build your altar, I'll build mine. You pray all day long, I'll pray to my God, and let's see whose God is real. And they prayed all day, and they cut themselves to try to get their God to respond. And then they prayed, and nothing happened. And Elijah walked up and said just one simple prayer, God, show that you are real. And fire fell from heaven and consumed the altar. The people realized which God was real. They turned on the false prophets. They killed all of them, hundreds of them. And so Elijah saw God move in a mighty way, and this is the next moments that we hear from Elijah, this mountaintop experience. And now this is Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 1 says this. Now Ahab told Jezebel, she's the queen, everything that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. And so Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah and said, may the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like one of them. And I'm just going to read the first part of verse 3. Elijah became afraid. Interesting that the guy who had just saw God do amazing things And now he is looking around, and there is a perceived danger. There is a danger that he can see. Jezebel is mad, and the queen is coming after me, and I know she's got a big army, and this is a problem for my life. And he becomes afraid. How could the prophet of God, who was so strong one minute, be so weak the next? How could the prophet who just saw God answer a prayer, fire fell from heaven. He won the day. He defeated hundreds of false prophets, and now he's afraid of Queen Jezebel because she's angry and she's sending an army after him. Strong one minute, weak another. Faith one minute, not faith the next. Maybe you and I can relate. If you take nothing else from this part of the story, take it for that if even Elijah can be weak and can fail, and even if even Elijah can become afraid, then so will we. And maybe today you would give yourself a little grace for the moments when you fail God. Maybe you'll give yourself a little bit of forgiveness for the times when you were weak, because I'm not going to stand up here today and just read Bible verses to you and say, do better, because you know that you should do better. I know that I should be stronger. The enemy tells me all the time. He tells you, you should be better. You should be stronger. Why are you weak? You're supposed to be a follower. You should have more faith. You should be able to resist. And yet we don't. And yet, if Elijah, the high prophet of the Lord, became afraid and ran, then maybe you can forgive yourself in moments when you are afraid because of you see a real danger against your marriage and against your family, against your kids, against your faith. And if you see those dangers lining up, it's okay to be afraid. Fear is not bad in of itself. Fear is healthy because it helps preserve and protect you. But don't let your fear overwhelm you and rule the day. Elijah saw real danger and he became afraid. How about you? So many of you in this room, I could just go around the room and give you a microphone, and many of you could talk about a real danger, something that's difficult in your life that you're struggling with, and moments you feel weak and unable to handle it, overwhelmed, maybe even afraid. One of the causes and the reasons that we fear is because we see real dangers. And yet God gives us promises in his word that these things will not overtake us. Deuteronomy 31:6 says, be strong and courageous. Do not, what? Fear. Do not fear or be terrified because of them. For the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. It says to be strong and courageous. Don't be fear or terrified. Terrified is double the fear. A little bit of fear, whole lot of fear is terror. Do not be terrified because of who? Because of them, the enemy, because of those things that are warring against you, those people or those things, the outward things, the inner things. Do not be terrified of them because the Lord is with you. He goes with you. He will never leave you. It says he will never forsake you, Deuteronomy 31:6. John 16:33. This is Jesus talking. I have told you these things so that in me you can have peace. In this world you will have trouble. Can somebody say amen to that? You will have trouble. It's going to happen to all of us. But take heart, because I have overcome the world. God wants to tell Elijah, I know Jezebel's coming for you, but I'm with you. And I'm stronger than she is. And yet, in that moment, he is afraid because of the dangers that he sees. The second thing I want you to see is not the dangers that we see, but it's also the despair that you feel. The despair that you feel. Watch what happens to Elijah in that moment that he is afraid, and watch how his emotions take over and rule the day. We're at verse 3. It says this, Elijah was afraid, and he ran for his life, and when he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there. And while he himself went on a day's journey into the desert, he came to a broom tree. He sat down under it and prayed that he might die. "I've had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors." And he lay down under the tree and he fell asleep. How is it possible that the prophet of God, who could be so brave one minute, can now become afraid and run, and now he's gone from fear to something totally different? He's not just afraid, now he is experiencing despair, right? He is despairing. He is, you see that emotion in him? God, I am done. I can't do it anymore. Just go ahead and take my life. How is it possible that a human could go to despair so quickly, who sees God on their side, who's a follower of Yahweh and sees him so many things in his life, God giving victory on a day-to-day basis. And now he is despairing, saying, "I want to quit. I want to run. Just take my life." Did you know that science tells us there's a portion of our brain called the amygdala? And the amygdala, its job is to control the emotions that we have. And when fear comes and we see a perceived danger, the amygdala fires all these chemicals in our brain. And in that moment, your emotions hijack reason of your brain. It completely hijacks your thinking and your reason and your reactions. Ever wonder why you respond the way you do? Your emotions go out of control, and you start making decisions based on your emotions because that's what's controlling your mind and your body in those moments. Reason doesn't matter. He's like, "I shouldn't be acting this way, but I do. I shouldn't be thinking this way, and yet I do." And you know rationally you should not be afraid because you're a believer and follower of Jesus, and you know that God is with you and he can do all things, but in those moments, you know. But you can't stop because your emotions have hijacked your body. Can you see that in Elijah's life in those moments? He wants to be strong for the Lord. He just witnessed it, and now he's running, and now he stops under a tree and just says, "God, I'm done. I can't do it anymore." His emotions are ruling his body and his mind and his rational thought. And in those moments, he is not where God wants him to be. He is going the wrong way. Direction, walking out into the desert alone, wondering how he got there. It is the emotion and the despair that he feels. Psalm 56:34 says, "When I am afraid," this is David talking, while he was in the desert and Saul's army is chasing him, he said, "When I am afraid, I will trust in you, in God's whose word I praise, in God I trust. I will not be afraid." Do your emotions hijack you and send you somewhere and they tell you to run and to quit and to give up? Those are not words from the Lord. Those are words from the enemy that's telling you that you can't win, that you need to despair, that you need to worry. And all those emotions are guiding your steps in the wrong direction. Notice also that he says this. He says, "I want to die." Let me speak to that for just a second. Anytime you, teenagers, listen to me. Anytime that you or anyone else in the room has feelings of self-harm, where you feel like that you need to end your life or take a knife and cut yourself to relieve stress, and those thoughts of self-destruction to you or anybody else, those do not come from the Lord. Those are from the enemy himself. God does not condemn. The enemy comes to condemn. God convicts and restores and forgives and brings healing, not condemnation. We are not condemned because of Christ Jesus who has died for us. We have forgiveness and restoration. When you hear those thoughts of "I am done, end my life," recognize where those come from. Those are not from God. That is not his plan. That is, emotions are ruling the day. And in those moments, those emotions are blocking out reason. And if you'll hang on a little while and go tell somebody and tell somebody that you're having these thoughts, they will help protect you until those emotions calm down and reason restores. We need to recognize when our emotions have hijacked our bodies and our minds and cause us to make bad decisions and bad choices, and those emotions say quit on the marriage and walk away. Those emotions say give up on the kids and walk away. The emotion says you'll never be what God wants you to be. You might as well just stop trying. Those voices are not from God. Elijah was in the moment overwhelmed by his emotions because of the despair that he felt. The third thing I want you to see in this story is not just the despair, but I want you to know that he is able to go and he is able to come and he's going to look ahead. And the disasters that you imagine might happen. We play the what-if game with God, and we say, God, what if this happens? What if that happens? Look at Elijah and listen to the emotions that he says. He goes and talks to God. Emotions are still winning the day. Verse 9, he says, he went into a cave, and he spent the night. And the word of the Lord came to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? And he replied, I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant. They've broken down your altars. They put your prophets to death with the sword. And I am the only one left. And now they're trying to kill me too. You hear the despair in his voice? Everybody has abandoned you, God. Everybody's against you. They're killing other prophets of God, and now I am the only one left. He's playing the what-if game with God. What if I go back? What's that going to be like? Where am I going to stay? Because everyone's against me. How am I going to live? How's my family going to survive? What if they do this? What if Jezebel finds me? And this thought of what might happen into the future, the disasters that could be coming are overwhelming him, and he's talking to God in his emotions of despair, not in moments of reason. Can anybody in here relate to that? You ever go to God in emotional despair? God, what if? What if? What if? And yet, God tells him. He tells him to go out on the front of the cave and meet with the Lord. And I want you to see where he finds the Lord. Verse 11, the Lord says, go out and stand on the mountain. Go stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. And this is what he saw. A great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart, shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. Some of you have went through a hurricane just recently. You might have been in Florida and you had to evacuate. Maybe you're in Florida and you were not affected by that. But millions of people experienced a hurricane. If you've never been through one, I have. And there's a whole lot of wind going on. There's a whole lot of wind. And it is loud and it is roaring. And you hunker down in your house and you just pray that it survives, that your house stays strong. He said he looked in the wind that was tearing apart the mountains, but the Lord was not in that. After that, an earthquake came. And then after the earthquake came a fire. But the Lord was not in the earthquake, and he was not in the fire. When your emotions are ruling today, and the fear is running your thoughts and your life, there are a lot of voices in your head, outside voices, inside voices, and they are loud, and they're telling you what you could do, and they're condemning you because you're not better, and you're trying to figure out where you should go and how God is going to speak to you, and watch what happens for Elijah. Here's where he found the Lord, not in the loud, not in the wind, not in the storm, not in the earthquake or the fire. It says, after the fire came a gentle whisper. The Lord whispered to him. And it goes on to say that Elijah, when he heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and he went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. And then God whispered this to him. You ready? Listen to this. What are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here physically in the cave? What are you doing here in your mind and in your heart? Why are you fearful, Elijah? Why are you afraid? Why are you running? And I imagine the conversation, if it continued on, would have been something like this. But God, you don't understand. Jezebel is mad at me, and she sent an army, and they're going to come kill me. And God would have said, that's not real. That fear is not real. Jezebel will not touch you because I am with you and she will not win. I'm more powerful than her. That's not a real fear. That fear has taken over your heart and your life, Elijah. Why are you here? Well, God, I'm all alone. Everybody else has been killed. Everybody else has abandoned you and me, and now I'm here all alone. And God would have said, Elijah, that's not real either. You are not alone. You are not alone in this because I am with you. There are other people that are waiting for you to come back and to lead and to grow and to follow the Lord. They're waiting on you. But you, Elijah, watch this. You isolated yourself. You ran away, and now you're in a cave in the middle of the desert complaining about being alone. You're not alone. That is not real. You did that because you let your emotions of fear control your life. And then God spoke to him, go back to where I want you to be. And Elijah heard the voice of God, that gentle whisper in his heart. And God spoke to him and said, go and do this, this, and this. And Elijah was restored because God spoke to his heart, because he sought after the Lord. How about you? If you find yourself afraid today, how about you? Where are you looking? What voice are you turning into? Who are you looking for direction or for peace or for comfort? Where are you looking? Are you looking in the big and the loud, or are you sitting at the end of the cave listening to the voice of God? He's whispering to your heart right now. Do you hear him? You hear him saying, what are you doing here in this part of your life? What are you afraid of? I am with you. Don't be afraid. I'm enough. I'm stronger than anything that you will face. Can you feel it? Can you hear him? Would you just close your eyes right where you are? Nobody move. Just close your eyes. Listen for that still, small voice. What are you afraid of? The danger that you see? The despair that you feel? The disasters that might happen? What are you afraid of? Psalm 34 says, I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and he delivered me from all of my fears. Is that your heart today? That he would deliver you from that which has overtaken your reason, caused you to run and to doubt, to give up? Let him speak truth to you today, in this moment. Speak to us, God. Father God, in these moments, I pray, Lord, that you would do a work in us, that we would forgive ourselves for being human and for being frail, and for having moments of weakness. It happened to Elijah. It can happen to us. It can happen to anybody. And in these moments, I pray that you would forgive us so that we can forgive ourselves for being human. And I pray, Lord, that we would not despair and give up, because we know that you are with us. And whatever we face, you're bigger than that. You're stronger than that. God, I know that you're going to do a work in our lives. We turn to you today because we need you in this moment. We need you, Father. More than anything else, God, we're seeking after you so that you will hear us and you can deliver us from all of our fears. Father, I pray that we would hear that still, small voice, that whisper that says, I've got you. It's going to be okay because I am with you. Father God, in these moments, I pray that we would do business with you. We would surrender to you. Stop listening to the loud, the chaotic, or even what seems to be powerful. We would sit at your feet and let you speak truth that cuts through our emotions and cuts straight to our heart, and that we would see truth and the truth would set us free. Father, in these moments, we are listening and we are celebrating you, our Lord and our Redeemer. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Time of response. You can stay seated during this song if you would like to just sit in the presence of the Lord. You can stand and you can sing and rejoice that he is your deliverer. There's altar here. You can come and kneel and to pray and listen to that still, quiet voice of the Lord. There's staff down front. We would love to pray with you about anything that you're going through, however God speaks to you. I'm going to ask you to respond to that. So I'm going to ask that you can sit or you can stand, but as God speaks to your heart, you respond to him today.
No longer I who live, but Christ in me, for I've been born again. My heart is free, the hope of heaven before me, the grave behind. Hallelujah.
it's my privilege to welcome Mr. Joe Hayes to the stage with me. And Joe recently, I believe, completed his degree and is back in the Nashville area. And he has been saved for quite some time, and he has followed God in believer's baptism. And he is here today to unite with the Parkway family. So if you will welcome him into our family and agree to pray for him, give it him the Parkway wave. Parkway family, thank you so much for those of you that helped and supported the harvest party. It meant a great deal to me. And on a note of closing, in 2 weeks, we're going to have our Thanksgiving feast. That is on Sunday night, November 17th at 6 p.m. The information is in your bulletin. There's a QR code you can register with, or Miss Granny Glow will be in the back to accept cash or check for tickets. Thank you. Be sure to come welcome Mr. Joe, and we will see you next week.